this worship. Be in this room with us, Lord, and let us feel you in our hearts. And Lord, I just pray for your guidance and your direction daily. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
I'm not doing some opening welcome like it says on this thing. I don't know what he's up to. Huh? No. Well, good morning. Hello. How are you all? Please stay standing, and I will try not to be rude. Page 345.
Good morning. In the back of your bulletin are your announcements. Just real quick, Jackie and Becky made it home safe. Becky's a little bit under the weather, so I'm sure Jackie's helping out as much as he can. No, I talked to him. She got what everybody else got going around, the coughing, the hacking, and all that stuff. So. Yeah, she enjoyed the beach. Everything went good. The hurricane came through and flooded the streets for a day, and the wind got up, but everything else was pretty good. So we're glad that they're back home safe. Sign-up sheets for meals are in the back, Takeaway Tuesdays. Again, donations of individual bags of chips, Kool-Aid, Capri Sun, bottles of water, snack cakes. They are needing tube socks. Just something you just don't hear every day. For the Christmas play, they're needing tube socks. So if you got any old tubes, she said she'll take them how she gets them. Old ones, I know y'all still got them yellow stripe or red stripe tube socks from years gone by. Yeah. They can have holes in them, whatever, but they just need some. Youth lock-in September 15th and 16th. 7 p.m. 7 a.m. Please be sure to get with Candance and Ebony so they can get you the permission slip for your child, okay? Also in the back, there is a draft of the budget that we'll be voting on next month in the back. We're going to have bigger. This time of year, we need a great big table for sign-up sheet, so we'll probably try to get a bigger table back there. Ice Cream Social coming up September 9th, 6:30. I believe there's a sign-up sheet back there for that too, right? You can even sign up to be on the sign-up sheet if you. I think that's all I've got. Anybody got anything else that I'm forgetting? Good. Is everybody with me this morning? All right. You got any birthdays or anniversaries? Jerry, Thelma, Debbie. What are you up here for? Oh, yeah, we got an anniversary. How many years, Amy?
Oh, God, I don't know. 22.
There you go, 22 years. I will not ask on the birthday numbers. We're all 29, right? Why don't y'all stand? Let's sing happy birthday first.
As you make your way back to your seats, we'll turn to 451 and we'll tell it to Jesus. Tell Kathy to sit down.
Tell it
age, anybody? Debbie?
Last week, I put that $2,500 on this side of the church under the pew. Now, this side's got more people in it. And I hate to inform you, but about six pews back right there in the corner is where I put it this week. So I apologize. I'm sorry nobody got it, but we'll see. Eventually, it'll even out and somebody's going to get that. We'll come in here next Sunday and every pew will be upside down. Edith be in here sweating. I can't find it nowhere. We're going to do something a little bit different this week. I want to have kind of a prayer request and praise time. And I'll be honest with you. I saw Paul Briscoe at Lockport do it, and I told him, I said, I think that's fantastic. Now, he said sometimes they get 45 minutes into it, and he has to say, hold up. We'll praise a little. We'll praise after church, but has anybody got any prayer requests that are not on this list? First and foremost, put your dad. Yeah, I told him if he wanted a deer that bad, season's open, I could get him one. He does not have to mow one down with that motorcycle. Steve's doing okay, though, right? He's stubborn, but he's doing okay. Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. Yeah, I heard about that this morning. That's awful. We'll keep family in prayer. Okay. I'd like to add to my cousin Michael Temple. Some of you know him. My Aunt Patsy, my mom's sister Patsy. Her son was in the hospital for about 2 days. He waited about 5 days to go in. He had such a horrible headache. Right arm was swollen. By the time he went in there, his organs were starting to become inflamed. five doctors, five specialists later, and they still have zero idea what's going on. They let him out yesterday. His head is feeling better, but they found a dark spot behind his heart, between his heart and lung. Not sure what's going on. They don't float the word around that he's scared that it is, but he is doing better. Just stubborn for waiting 5 days to go into the hospital, but I don't know where he gets that from. The tingle side of the family, more than likely. Got any praises? Glad to be here. Go ahead. Solid. Seen you last week. Good to have you back, too. Grown up, too. Beard ought not be thicker than mine, but whatever. We'll talk about that later. I'm Megan. Those of you that don't know, Mike Mounts, where she was referring to him coming up the aisle, and we were gone, or I was gone that weekend that he actually was at the camp. He walked, and a lot of us, that's like, oh well, he walked. He shouldn't have been able to walk to this altar. But he wanted to become a member of this church so badly. And that's not to put our church above anything else. That's God. All the glory goes to God in that. But he walked up here and he did that and shortly after passed. So I tell everybody, this is probably one of the most loving churches. We got a whole lot of faults and we own every one of them. But this is by far one of the most loving churches, and that's just another testimony to that. That's because we give the glory to God, and that's where it goes. That's where it's supposed to be. Thank you, Megan. Had the first class this morning for the high school, college age kids. It's so odd to me, and Ricky said it this morning, did a teacher go down there? And Jenna's actually teaching that class. And when we first talked about and approached Jenna, she didn't hesitate. And to watch that progression throughout these years, and to see it happening now is ridiculously unbelievable to me. I believe it because she's such a sweet girl and she's been raised in this church. But to take something like that on is not easy. And I think big things are going to come from that particular class. And thank you, Jenna, so much for doing it, because they don't want to hear none of the rest of us. So that's going to be fantastic. Debbie, do you have something? Oh, really? Yeah. First night back Tuesday, yeah, 15. And I know eventually the planning has come together for archery. It's going to happen. Just got to figure out a good time for that. So things are moving in the right direction, folks. And we always do that the busiest times of the year. We try to get busier. Do you ever notice that? But that's okay. That's a good thing. All right, today's scripture comes from Hebrews, And I'll just warn you, this comes from the New Living Translation. I don't take a lot of that, a lot of times from that translation, but I like this one. So Hebrews 12:12-15. So take a new grip with your tired hands and strengthen your weak knees. Mark out a straight path for your feet so that those who are weak and lame will not fall, but become very strong. Work at living in peace with everyone and work at living a holy life, for those who are not holy will not see the Lord. Look after each other so that none of you fails to receive the grace of God. Watch out that no poisonous root of bitterness grows up to trouble you, corrupting many. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word.
So, of course, I never do anything new. Well, many of you will have heard this, but we do have a lot of people that haven't heard it. So, you know, this song speaks to me because, sorry, I'm a little bit scratchy too. You know, trusting in God for everything is a big ask to me. So, you know, when I think about faith and when I think about trust and, you know, just, you know, that old saying, let go and let God, that's difficult because although I'm not an overly controlling person, I do want things to be how I want them. And that's never what God has in mind for you. So, you know, it's important for us to set what we want aside and remember to have that faith, that undying faith that God has it all under control, and he knows what's best, and we have to listen and do what he says. So, so that said, I guess I'll shut up talking and sing. I'm so confused. Thank you.
pretty good. Thank you, ma'am. She was a nervous wreck about that day. I'll go on and say that. She did great. Did a great job. So has anybody ever seen American Ninja Warrior? Oh, not a lot, though. What y'all been doing? It's great. Watching Andy Griffith. I hear you. Well, I'm right there with you on that one. Well, for those of you that don't know, it's an obstacle course. It's a really hard obstacle course that men and women and now, even today, kids compete in. Right? And it's many of them train in what's called parkour or free running. Right? So they're jumping and running off walls. They look like if you scare a herd of cats, it looks like them jumping all around, right? I can do that. I run into walls on a daily basis. I might not jump off of them, but I run into them. That's pretty much what they're doing. But it is really, really remarkable what the human body is capable of. But what I've noticed is the best athletes that they always have on there are rock climbers. These people that can go up and find a crack a quarter inch deep in a mountainside and hang from it for days. It's ridiculous. I still don't believe it when I see it. And then they can pull their whole selves up by that. Well, these are the people that do the best in that show. I mean, I'm worn out just thinking about it. But the reason they're so successful is because they practice that every day. They didn't just wake up one day and go out to a mountainside and go, here, I'm going to hang on this for a while. I'm strong enough. That's not how that happens. They practiced every day to develop that strength over time. And by building the strength with each day they work out and each time they tried it. They didn't just wake up with it. And they had to go through the tough times of learning and failing until they got to the point that they're at. But they continued to climb. And I think that's the most important thing. That's how this scripture hit me today. God uses discipline in our lives to shape us and to make us stronger. And you know, you always hear the same question over and over. Why do I have to go through the things that I've gone through? And I'm not saying that God put that cancer in somebody's body. I'm not saying that God put that car in the four-way intersection just at the same time as yours. I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is God gives us a way to get through those trials. God gives us the discipline to go through the circumstances in life in order to strengthen us and in order to bring us closer to Him or back to Him. It shapes our character, and it teaches us how to know that we can rely on God at the same time use our strength through Him to pull us through those trials. Because so many times we go through trials and we want to sit and stew in it. Everybody in this room knows somebody that absolutely loves when times are hard. You know what I'm talking about. When somebody just every day is like, well, nothing's wrong today. This ain't going to be a good day. I got some family that do that. But we want to sit and stew in it instead of finding our grip and looking for God to give us the strength and pull ourselves up. And here the writers of Hebrews are telling us to get a grip and be the person that God intended us to be. But a lot of times in order to take a new grip with your tired hands and strengthen ourselves, we get tired. We get discouraged. Things don't exactly go the way that we want them to do, and we end up having kind of a little pity party and maybe a little whiny session. And some of you are going, how does he know that? I do it too. Had a meeting the other day. Went out to lunch with a group of people and just had a good meeting. But at the same time, I knew the outcome was probably going to be the same as it was before I walked in there. And all the way home, I had a pity party. Why? Why do I keep putting all this time and effort into something that probably is not going to happen, but yeah, we keep doing it and keep doing it. And then I had gotten to the point where I had to pull off the road and pray. And I don't face that very often, that I have to actually get off the road for fear of running into somebody, and I had to pray. And I got the answer that I usually get. Suck it up, buttercup. Stop whining. You got a million other things going on, and that's just a little speck of it. So let's keep going and moving on. Yes, that's the relationship that I have with God. But something else popped in my head, and you hear it said so many times. Man, I miss the good old days. Ah, the good old days. Andy Griffith, I miss the good old days. But the more I thought about that, the more I thought back to the problems of the good old days. And there was issues in the good old days. So no matter if we're living in today or we're living in the past, there's always going to be those issues. So we're to get a grip. Don't sit stagnant. Keep moving forward. So as we look deeper into the scripture today, we see four ways that we can get a grip and renew our faith and our life through God, if it works right. The first one is commit or recommit your lives. Verse 12 says, so take a new grip with your tired hands and strengthen your weak knees. Sometimes to get a new grip, we have to take a look at the old grip. Look at your life. What are you committed to? Your marriage, your relationships, as you should, your job, your family. All of those things are worthy of your commitment. But so is God. He should be at the top of the list, but we get so busy with all these other commitments that he tends to fall to the back of the line. But I'm here to tell you today that if you take that time and that commitment with God to grow closer, to get closer to God, guess what? All those other commitments get to benefit from it too. And that's what we don't realize, is everything else in our life gets to benefit from our time with God, our families, our marriages, our jobs. Everything will benefit if we just put God in front. There was a, I saw it on the History Channel, so it's got to be true. I did a little bit of research. But General Garibaldi was an Italian military leader whose all-volunteer army, brought about the unification of what we call Italy in the 1840s. Italy was much like the U.S. was during a civil war. It was divided and it was separated. As he recruited for this army, this was the part of the speech that he would give. I offer neither pay nor quarters, nor provisions. I offer hunger, thirst, forced marches, battles, and death. Let him who loves his country with his heart and not with his lips only follow me. He was telling them that to follow him required a commitment. That's not the best sales pitch that you'll ever hear, but it required a commitment. Following Jesus Christ requires a commitment. It's not the little print at the bottom of a contract. It's the big bold print on the contract. To follow Jesus Christ requires a commitment. Not just for today, not just yesterday or tomorrow, but for all the days that we are on this earth and beyond. Jesus died for our sins, not just so we could live in this life. Not just so we could go through every day going, well, Jesus died for me. I can do what I want. That's not why he died. Jesus Christ died for our sins so that we could spend our eternity worshiping God. To spend our eternity with our Lord and Savior. And in order to achieve that, we have got to commit or recommit our lives. Next, we need to recognize the end goal. Verse 13 says, mark out a straight path for your feet so that those who are weak and lame will not fall but become strong. Know the end goal. Football season finally started. We're finally getting back to it. Something normal. It just feels normal when football season starts. I don't know what it is. But anybody in there that has been a running back or watches football knows that the coach wants that running back to get up the field as fast as he possibly can. He doesn't say, all right, I want you to take this ball and I want you to go to the sideline, go to the other end zone, go to this end zone, come back to the concession stand, and then get here. He doesn't say that. He says, I want you to take this ball and go from point A to point B as fast as you possibly can. Let's get it. Let's keep it moving forward. Always have the end goal in mind. And what are some of your goals? To retire? I know that's Amy's. That is like literally Amy's only goal, is to retire. Yeah, to retire. Can't wait to retire. To graduate, to raise your kids, have a successful business. Again, all worthy goals, right? But our main goal as a Christian should be to hear our Lord and Savior say the words that we hear in Matthew 25. It's a story where a master had entrusted three servants and various amounts of money and went away. And when he returned, he called them all together to see what they had done with that money. And two had been wise and had used and invested what they'd left with him. And he looked at them and he said, well done, my faithful servant, my good and faithful servant. That should be our end goal. That should be what we're looking at the finish line. Above all else, Jesus telling us, well done, my good and faithful servant, you have been faithful. Make your path straight. Next, we re-energize. Re-energize our faith. Verse 14 says, work at living in peace with everyone and work at living a holy life, for those who are not holy will not see the Lord. Work at living a holy life. We all need to do this, so I know I do. I'm constantly telling myself, man, you got to get re-energized. You got to get re-energized. It's a daily thing. Because if I don't, I know it won't take long for I backslide. Because that's what we do. The energy level in our faith goes down and we start backsliding. So how do we stay energized, you ask? I'll tell you. It's pretty simple. But it's hard at the same time. It's through discipline. The older I get, the more I realize the list of things I can't physically do get longer. Right? I used to go to the gym all the time. I would run. I'd do all these things, play softball and stay active. Back's hurting, legs hurting, knees hurting. Starting to mark things off the list that I can really do. But just because I can't run doesn't mean I can't go for a long walk. And the longer the walk I take, the stronger I find myself getting. If I take a few days off, then my legs start getting a little weak. It's the same way with our faith. If we stop trying to re-energize ourselves, if we stop trying to get into the Word of God, we stop trying to be a part of the church, then we start getting weak. And we don't even know it until it's almost too late. But the beauty of Jesus Christ is he knows that. God knows that we'll get weak, and he'll give us a little nudge every once in a while. We just got to pay attention to that nudge. Spiritual discipline, prayer, reading the Bible, church attendance, tithing, or just plain old time with God. How many days a week do you just sit and talk to God? How many days a week do you sit and just say, you know what, God, here's how my life's going. I know you know how it's going, but I'm going to talk to you today. I cannot tell you what that will do to your day, especially if you start it and end it that way. Everybody always says, I don't have time. I don't have time. When I get up in the morning, I try to talk, and I don't do it every day. I know Amy says on the way to work a lot of times, she's in the car, that's when she chooses to talk to God. Talk to God. Just that simple. You don't have to say there, you know, these and thous and thys and all that stuff. You don't have to sound like you're talking to God through the King James Bible. He understands you no matter what. He understands the unspoken word. That's all we have to do. But if we don't do these things, then we get weak. Just like our muscles, if we don't use them, they get weak. So we need to stay strong for the Lord so that we can meet that end goal. And we got to stay strong spiritually so that we see fulfilling of the Great Commission. Matthew 28:18. So then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of age." Folks, we don't live a holy life. We don't try to live a holy life just to please God and ourselves. It's so that people can see Jesus through us. He can see it. If you're walking down the street and somebody looks at you and watches how you interact with somebody and they don't know that you have the love of God in your heart, something's wrong. If they look at you and say, "Oh, I don't know if I'm going to be around that person or not," something's wrong. They need to see Jesus through us. Lastly, we got to renew our relationships. Verse 15 says, "Look after each other so that none of you fails to receive the grace of God. Watch out that no poisonous root of bitterness grows up to trouble you, corrupting many." We are to look after each other, to care for each other, and care for all, brethren, not just the ones that you particularly like. We all got that best buddy. We all got that one we turn to, right? And there's nothing wrong with that. But when it comes to caring for one another, we got to be there for each other. Repair those broken relationships. In Philippians 3:13, I think I put it on here. Nope, I went too far already. I might not put it on here. Philippians 3:13, as I put my glasses on, says, "Brothers, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus." He calls it the prize. Forget the past. Press forward. And it's hard to do. That's probably one of the harder things that we'll do in life is to forget. It's one of the hardest things we can do, and it rips families apart. I've seen it, and it's horrible. To let something of the past ruin it today. A little over a year ago, a year and a couple days, we lost what many of you knew was the best friend of anybody you ever met, Brian Daniel. And let me tell you, we renewed our brotherly relationship constantly. He never wanted to hear what I had to say, and I never wanted to hear what he had to say concerning our lives. We were brutally honest with each other, and we'd go weeks without talking to each other because we was mad. I thank God daily that he didn't take him before we were allowed to come back together and renew that relationship and manage to hug it out, because those days are gone. Folks, tomorrow is not promised. Never has been promised. Find it in the scripture where it says that you have tomorrow, because it don't. Renew those relationships. They will hold you back mentally. They will hold you back physically, and most important, they will hold you back spiritually. And that is something that you do not want to answer for one day. "Well, so-and-so said this about me 20 years ago, so I quit going to church because that's where they went." And we laugh, but it's true. It's true. So, don't let the things of the past keep you from moving forward in your own life. commit or recommit, recognize the end goal, re-energize your faith, and renew your relationship with your brothers and sisters in Christ. Now, I want you to do one thing for me this week. Just like having a physical at the doctor's office, I want you to take a spiritual physical. And I want you to, I don't even think, yeah, I didn't put them on there either. I'm horrible at PowerPoint. I want you to take a spiritual physical. I want you to ask yourself these questions. I want you to ask yourself, how much time do I spend with God a day? Is it once? Is it twice? I want you to ask yourself, how many times do I pray each day? How many times have I been to church in the last few months? How many times have I reached out to somebody that I know is hurting and needs to hear a voice? Any voice. And I want you to come up with your own question. I want you to ask yourself that. You don't have to bring it back next week. There's no prize involved. I'm not giving out anything for that. But I think every day we each need to do a spiritual, physical, and see where we're at and recommit and renew our faith in Jesus Christ. Stay on your toes and keep your faith strong. The finish line waits where one day we are either going to be told, I don't know you, or well done, my good and faithful servant. That's the last question you should ask yourself, is what's my answer going to be? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the words that you give us, the inspiration that you give us every day, Lord. But I pray so much, Lord, that every heart be open, every mind be open, every physical part of our being be open to you daily, that we exercise our faith, Lord. We don't just sit on it. We don't just say stay stagnant. We exercise our faith every single day, Lord, that people may know you through us. Lord, I pray that you use everybody in this room as a vessel for your word and your love. And I pray, Lord, that you continue to guide us and direct us in whichever direction you may want us to go. And it's in your heavenly name we pray. Amen. I'll be down front. If you want to come pray at the altar, if you want to come take my hand, if